Hello everybody, welcome. I'm very, very happy to be here again. I think it's meanwhile my third conference here with Yelsken. So, very nice. Sajid, come on in. So, what I'm going to present today, I do not want to go too deep into real mapping examples. I'd rather like to stress about the technology background, and we have had a lot of exciting new announcements. There were a lot of new sensors coming, and we still can expect a lot of exciting stuff for the next 2 years or so. And I want to take you on a little tour that you understand what's going to happen at Velodyne and what the future will bring and what is the current state of the art in our technology and which sensors you can choose from. So, as Pierre announced, I'm Dieter Gabriel. I'm heading the Europe or the EMEA marketing for Velodyne. And let's start a bit with a little history. We heard in the initial presentation this morning from Joe Hutton, he was giving some examples regarding history of a few things. And we discovered that it is actually worth to see how Velodyne evolved. So how did it all start? So it goes back to, meanwhile, 1983. So we are quite a long time around in the market. And still today, if you Google Velodyne nowadays, you might end up at nice web pages showing you some loudspeakers. So that's where Velodyne's got its origin from. Originally, we started with loudspeaker business. And in 83, our founder and owner, David Hall, came up with a nice patent where he could measure distortions, more or less in real time, distortions on the membrane of a loudspeaker, subwoofer actually. So what he did is that he dealt with his measurements that way, that in the end he was capable to correct the distortions in more or less real time. And while doing so, he could adjust the loudspeaker in that way that he gave you brilliant, clear sound without any distortions. And in doing so, in the end, actually, he became one of the fathers of modern sound technology, like we use from Dolby Surround, from THX and so. So he laid part of foundation of this kind of development. So you might ask yourself, hey, what the hell did these guys, that's an acoustic company, it was formerly an acoustic company, and now we are within kind of optical systems. If you think about it, at the very basics of physics, it's not that far apart, there is not such a big gap. Because what do you do if you treat acoustic wavelengths? You have to deal with some waveforms, you have to deal with electromagnetic waves at the basic of the physics, and if it is acoustics or if it is optical wavelengths, it's fairly the same. The trick is you've got to have know-how how to treat these signals very, very fast and to deal with it as fast as possible. So, and loudspeakers, there is not that much innovation as such. So if you've bought a very good audio system maybe 30 years ago, usually you will still be happy with it if you've got some high-end loudspeakers. Well, nowadays they put Alexa to it, you have OSB connection and I don't know what kind of stuff. But in principle, the quality of the sound system was 30 years as good as it is today. So by the time this kind of business got boring and our founder was looking for new challenges, and here it was. So it started all 2004 with the DARPA Grand Challenge. And DapaCon Challenge that was a competition launched by the research department of US Ministry of Defense. So very famous events always. And we see here a nice quote from David Hall. The first time he was participating in DARPA, he used cameras. And the task, the challenge was to equip a vehicle with some kind of sensor technology that the vehicle would be capable to navigate, to maneuver as autonomous as possible to through difficult terrain. And that nice quote says, hey, I can see all the road some of the time, or some of the road all the time, but I was never going to see everything all the time. And so he thought by himself, well, with camera technology alone, it's not so good. And that was the point where he had the idea using lasers, and not just some kind of laser, but multi-channel, a multi-layer sensor system. That means a sensor comprising lots of different lasers, means laser diodes. And you see that the first system he had was quite big. Not so nice to put on a drone. Also not nowadays. It would be fairly a bit too heavy. But that was it where it all started, back in 2005. So he invented the first laser system, and after that, the guys from the Defense Department came to David Hall and said, hey, this is such a brilliant idea, and it shows so promising results. Actually, we think it would be a good idea if you do not spend too much efforts to compete in the next challenges, in the next DARPA challenge. Why not bring this transfer this into a commercial product? And that was how Velodyne LiDAR started, actually. So, well, and since 2007, we are in commercial production of laser sensors, and yeah, it has grown. So you see here, part of our manufacturing capability in San Jose, in Silicon Valley. Yeah, and meanwhile, we are an undisputed market leader for multi-channel, real-time 3D laser systems. And yeah, so our old headquarters, we're in Morgan Hill. At the southern end of the Silicon Valley. Meanwhile, we have this new global headquarters with a huge factory that we call Mega Factory, because it's really huge, and we have a capacity to produce LiDAR sensors where, if we ramp up full production, we'll be capable to have 1 million LiDAR sensors produced just at this site here. And that's where I'm located. That's the German office, close to Frankfurt. We are just a couple of minutes from Frankfurt Airport, very well situated. And the Europe team covers all EMEA, so Europe, Middle East, and Africa. So from loudspeakers to the DARPA Grand Challenge to the first steps with a multi-channel laser. You see here the main segments our sensors are suited for, and these are the main segments we address. So, and it's important for me that you understand about how we treat the certain industry segments. By far the most important segment for the future is automotive. So automotive is the segment that offers the most chances for us. And on the other hand, because so many efforts for the time being and in the coming future are spent from side of the automotive industry, from the OEMs and the tier ones, to get better sensors, because all have understood that LiDAR is an inevitable key enabler for making cars become autonomous. So it's meanwhile more or less accepted that the future of autonomous vehicles will be a combination of at least three sensors: camera, LiDAR, and radar, maybe ultrasonic as well. But one inevitable key component is definitely LIDAR. Why do I tell this? Why I stress this at mapping conference? Because all these efforts undertaken here will pay off in significant technological breakthroughs. Sorry, and the benefit you see later in my presentation, we all participate in this new. Developments from these new developments, and we get better sensors in the future. That's the main area of interest here at the conference, and we see more and more interest, rising interest from sides of security applications or in general industry demand, maybe in the AGV sector, port technologies, and so on. But we shouldn't forget what's the major topic here. So we're here at YellowScan. We heard a bit about the surveyor in the morning. The big advantage of our sensors is lightweight, small form factor. In general, more or less the lowest power consumption, lowest specs regarding power consumption you will find in the market. So it makes it very attractive for use on drones. I thought it over quite, what's here? Thought it over quite some time if I should present a few general basics. I use these slides since many years and I just want to go through it with you a few seconds because I'm not quite sure if everybody of you is aware about these things. So what is a major advantage if we talk about multi-channel laser systems, LIDAR? Multi-channel means, in our case, at least 16 laser channels, actually 32, 64, and even more meanwhile. So a big advantage you see here. So you have 16 or 32 lasers looking down in a certain field of view, usually with our sensors between 30 and 40 degrees vertical field of view, and all our spinning sensors, rotational ones, provide you 360 degrees horizontal. So if you put it now on a platform, it may be a drone, it may be a vehicle, it may be a boat, whatever. So you move from A to B and you scan a certain area of interest, in our case, the bottom, or it may be a power line, and so on. So what happens is you have, in comparison to a classical two-dimensional laser, not just one scan line or just a few, but you have plenty of them. So what happens now if the platform gets into trouble because of turbulence or whatever, if you have quick movements, if you're affected by jumps on the ground, it may be speed bumpers or whatever, in the plane it might be air turbulence. So you will not lose data. If you just have one or two or three laser lines and you have a quick jump, it may be that you simply have a gap in your data collection. This is rather not to happen here. And just a very simple example I love very much, not from here, but just using a sensor maybe in a room like this here, I want to show you here. So what makes the difference between a single line laser and a multi-channel laser? This is just our room at the Europe headquarter, and this is the representation of a single line laser. You see a colleague of mine walking around. That's, by the way, the same how autonomous forklifts operate today, with just that kind of map. And so, therefore, they use usually magnetic markers or such help aids. And here, so I don't have to explain, we switch now to a system with 32 laser lines. It's a multi-channel 32 laser. So you see pretty much more of my colleague here. By the way, that's me here sitting at my desk. So this is the difference between just poor laser scan information and multiple laser lines. So, and this is just an example of raw data. It is just the data as it comes out of the sensor. So you still see the gaps between the laser lines. They drive actually the resolution, the spatial resolution we can get out of the system. We have here in that example an opening angle of 1.3 degrees between the individual lasers. I come back to this later. So again, to demonstrate what makes the difference. Here we have a classical 2D laser. The platform is moving from here to here. We have a parked object, a parked car, for instance. We have houses in the background, and you see a lot of shadow. And what you also clearly see, you cannot get a lot of objects behind, like with rectangles, with houses here. So you end up with a lot of significant shadow. Now, if we come to a spinning Velodyne laser with a vertical field of view of, say, 30 to 40 degrees, what happens is this here. So you scan in your one path, right? And then we will have this effect. So in fact, due to the field of view, you partly see actually a bit back. You see in more directions. And you see here the difference, these objects, these houses in the background, you get much more data capture. You get much more points per square meter than with that other approach. And to demonstrate it, how it looks in practice, so these are real life examples. So from the same scenery with 2D laser, you end up with a lot of shadows and you by far do not see that much details like we have here in the background. Another thing, calibrated reflectivities. Calibrated reflectivities are important for a lot of applications within mapping. So what's happening here? At first glance, you might think by yourself, why is he showing us this type of image? So it's not so impressive. It's very, very interesting because what you see here, the mapping platform moved from here to here. And perpendicular to the trajectory, we see the number plates of parked vehicles. And because of the effect I just showed you the slide before, because of that vertical field of view of maybe 30, 40 degrees, we look partly back, and even if the trajectory went from here to here, you see the signals, the reflection signals of number plates. Enough of theory. I show you a few examples. Not only from yellow skin, we are around globally in a lot of areas. So this is an example from company Hovermap. This is not mapping, this is actually real time, not that much post-processed data, quite real time, comparison of a telecom tower. It's quite interesting after a storm damage, you can easily compare before and after an event the position of objects. Next thing, and it pretty much refers to what I said before, think about the positive effect a multi-channel laser with a good field of view and many, many points gives you. Oh, sorry. What's that? So, flying over an airfield, and you see these planes, and you will simply discover something interesting. It was just a drone flight. It was just from above. But because of that multi-channel capabilities with a great field of view, you partly can see are these vessels equipped? What is here under the wings? And so in this case, you see there are no weapons on it. So if you simply would look with a standard laser from above, you wouldn't be able to discover this difference. Oh. Hmm? It's not automatic. Or for instance, if we map vegetation, like with forestry, and we do appropriate post-processing. Oh, good sound. So. The more laser beams you have available, the more points can penetrate the vegetation, and we have a capability of, in this case, using 700,000 or 1.4 million points per second in case we do a dual return evaluation. So you see both the vegetation area, and we go underneath, and you can get representation of real terrain. In this case, you see the dike here and everything. So again, it gives you great benefit. Or for example, you combine your imagery with hyperspectral, with camera, so you can get a lot of details out of your data. So you see here the actual LiDAR point count, you have a color representation, you have combination with adjusted vegetation index, so you can do a lot while evaluating your data. And I want to end this kind of practical demonstration with impressive example here from YellowScan that we had at the last event 2 years ago. So if you use the surveyor with LiveStation, we were at another chateau last time, but this is real-time data collected during the flight. So you see here the LiveStation on the ground, and this is what happens while the drone collects the data. And this was a standard VLP 16, so it gives you 600,000 points per second, and this is the kind of data you end up with in real time. In that case, not post-processed. Okay, I have to admit, thanks to the APX 15 from the planks. And by the way, if we think about this kind of application, it has not necessarily been example, airborne example, where we put the sensor on a drone. This is just a nice example I love very much from a backpack solution. So it's from one of our integrators in Italy. And here we have a nice example from the city of Bologna. So what these guys now do is, they have mounted one of our sensors, the HDL32, on a backpack, and go down into the underground. And again, you see real-time data that you can get with the sensors. I think that's quite impressive. And imagine if you do later more post-processing to it, you end up with an even better data set.
You have 10 more minutes.
Okay, oh, I have to speed up. So this was the practical part. Now, just a quick tour, what's the status of our sensors? So we have, you may well know, the VLP family, and we introduced a couple of new products recently and are still going to do. So we have the new solid state or directional laser family, that's the Velaray. We have the new VLS family. We started with the VLS 128. And we will have amazing side-looking sensors for the near-range detection. And what's important to understand, from now on, all our new sensors we deliver will happen at the end of the year, will come with the ASIC design. That means we have a chip that is more or less precise. Here you see the eye of George Washington on a dollar coin, and on the chip the laser diodes integrated, and we have transmitter and receiver together in this small assembly. We are the only company in the world who can do this right now. So we have a well-known PAC family, the standard PAC and PAC Lite, that comes with 590 grams and outstanding low power consumption. We have the Ultra PAC that you see in the Ultra Surveyor with 200 meters of range, at least 600,000 points per second, or in dual mode with 1.2 million. We came up recently with the new VLS family. It's not so interesting at the moment, maybe, to put it on drone, because the form factor is quite big, But what is important is the spatial resolution, the angular resolution. It comes with an opening angle of 0.1 degree. And all the new sensors will come to that. And you see here a few basic specs. So we bring this in form factor to other sizes. So we will have a VLS 128, 64, 32, 16. So we are getting very, very compact. And we improve a few things. And most important thing is the 0.1 angular resolution. Velray, our directional sensor, with 120 degrees horizontal, 35 in a vertical. So we just introduced the first ACLB rated, so with autograde specs, fulfilling autograde specs sensor at the CES in Las Vegas in January. So it will come with very much improved functional safety. And you get a lot of benefit out from that because the temperature range, the usage range, the durability, everything's got improved. Very, very, very robust sensor. Sorry. Next thing, this one here. It might be of interest for mapping as well. This is our first near-range sensor. It's the one and only worldwide half-hemisphere sensor, 180 by 180 degrees scan range. So it's targeted as to be used as classical blind spot detector for automotive applications, for AGVs, for security applications, but you could use it also on small vehicles or on drones, and you can fly in tunnel systems or wherever in narrow environments. 10% reflectivity in 30 meters. The black target, as all new sensors from us. So we end up with a quite big portfolio of sensors meanwhile. And what I'd like to stress here is that you pay attention to the amount of data you get. Nobody else provides you with that range of data capabilities. You get the most points per square meter when working with this sensor. So for new ones, if you think with the Alpha family, you go to 2.4 to 9.6 million. The new sensors will offer you the capability of using quadruple returns. You get four different modes of return, first, strongest, last, and something in between. So does this mean? We get a lot of variety. We meanwhile have to explain how our landscape looks like. And there are a lot more sensors to come in the next 2 and 3 years. And as I told you, most importantly, that AlphaPAC family we will have in several new varieties. So just to give you an impression, you know the Ultra Surveyor, the AlphaPAC, and it comes with 0.3 degrees angular resolution, and this is how real-time data looks. Unfortunately, I do not have it from the drone. This is vehicle-based, but this is how the real-time data looks. It's not the map data. You see still a few gaps in between. And why do I show this? Because I want to show you what the future brings with the 0.1 degree resolution, and you see it here. It's a bit loud again. So this is the AlphaPAC with 128 laser channels. We will make it smaller, 64, 32, and then it will be drone compatible. Real-time data, no SLAM, not post-processed. 300 meter range, 10% reflectivity on black target in 200 meter. And I have a nice example of a Velray with me. So you see here the photo stream and you see the scan examples. This is yet from an A0 sample. We have now meanwhile out the A1 and we've got rid of noise. You still hear, you're affected, still see here a lot of noise. The new data is amazing. It's absolutely amazing. And until autumn or latest end of year, we will have the B samples ready. So we are quite short before final release, industry release of the system. And what's amazing is that you see a lot of details from the live scan, and you can even read the signature on the trucks here. So I'm almost through with it. Just one important information, product naming. We've changed, we've rearranged our product names because we get too much sensors out now. We have such a big variety meanwhile. So what we agreed is to have the PAC, PAC Lite, PAC HRS. The VLP32 is labeled as Ultra PAC. And the VLS128 is Alpha PAC. And in future, we market three groups of products so that you not get confused when you hear about Velodyne. We have, that was too quick. We have the surround sensors, the directional lasers, and the short range sensors. And what you see here is called VelaBit. We will soon give you precise information. This will be a very, very small version of a directional Velaray. It is supposed to have a range of 80 meters and will be a very, very low cost sensor, and it's just 5 by 2 centimeters. And you can arrange it in a stack, and it gives you a huge capability to integrate it in whatever kind of platform. It's soon to come. So just final overview about the new things. That's important that the new sensors will have outstanding vertical resolution. You can get it with the directional ones down to 0.05 actually. We will have at least 200 meter range, or with the near range sensors up to 80. We have pretty much improved calibrated reflectivity, and the prices will get down soon as well. Regarding production quality prices, you may have heard already, we had it in a press beginning of the year. We have now set up a production partnership with Nikon in Japan, and we set up the facilities, the production environment, that we can roll out, that we can produce our sensors actually from the industrial belt. And this will be a major step forward, because we on first hand achieve even higher quality, and secondly we can come down with the pricing. And that's it, and I thank you for your thank you.